I'm Pam Cooper, co-founder of Boosterville, and I'm here to tell you that school fundraising stinks. 60 years ago, my grandma was a teacher whose students sold magazine subscriptions to buy library books. 30 years ago, my mom's marching band kids were pushing cheese and sausage to raise money to appear in the Rose Bowl parade. 10 years ago, it was me with wrapping paper and cookie dough for classroom supplies. I know school fundraising. It's a broken industry, but Boosterville fixes it. Your school gets the money you need, but so do the local businesses within your community. Boost your school while you boost your local businesses. Buy local, boost local. Choose Boosterville.
It's all about color. If you're Latino or Asian or black, you could get blasted anytime you walk out your door.
My name is Erin Gruwell.
Schools are divided into separate tribes.
I'm not sitting near him.
I can't go back there alone.
Man, I know you ain't talking to me.
We kill each other over race, pride, and respect. We fight for our America.
What you're saying is, if the Latinos weren't here, or the Cambodians, or the blacks, or the whites, or whoever they are, if they weren't here, everything would be better for you.
Man, stop acting like you're trying to understand our situation.
Why don't you explain it to me?
We in a war.
You're a first-time teacher. You can't make someone want an education. Listen to me, all of you.
Stand in the line if you've lost a friend to gang violence. Stand in the line if you've lost more than one friend. Three. Four or more.
From this moment on, the person you were, that person's turn's over. She told us we have something to say to people.
A couple days ago, I had the opportunity to talk to middle school students. And this very brazen sixth grader raised his hand, and the first thing he said to me was, you look a lot older than that woman in the movie, which was a great way to start off my presentation. Since we are dealing with parents and teachers, I'd like to do a special shout out to my father, who was a proud PTA member. And it's quite apropos that we are in the center of Cincinnati, because as a little girl, my father worked for the Big Red Machine, the Cincinnati Reds. Actually has those wonderful World Series rings from the era of Johnny Bench and Pete Rose and their coach Sparky Anderson. So as a little girl, my father went to everything. He was at every sporting event, when I was a cheerleader. And as a child, I watched my father, who always would roll up his sleeves and fight the good fight. And as a little girl, my father was this self-proclaimed civil rights activist. And I thought, you know what, when I grow up, I'm gonna be just like my dad. I too am gonna get in the trenches, I'm gonna roll up my sleeves and fight the good fight. Well, by that point, my father was much more successful. We moved to the suburbs. And suddenly, the only handicap we seemed to talk about at the dinner table was his golf score. And at that point, rather than talking about civil rights, he wanted me to go off to college and become a lawyer. And that way I could afford the life I was now accustomed to. So being that dutiful daughter, I did just that. I went off to college thinking I was gonna be a lawyer, turned on my television set, and I saw this young boy in the middle of Tiananmen Square, standing in front of a tank. And at that moment, I realized I had never stood up for anything. I'd gone to the right schools, I'd played the right sports, I'd been in the right clubs, had all the support, but I'd never stood up for anything. And at that moment, I realized, I don't think I want to stand in a courtroom in front of a judge and jury to make a difference. I think I want to stand in front of a classroom for all of those kids who don't have a father like I have. So when I told my dad I was no longer going to be a lawyer, he didn't take the news so well. And he quickly reminded me that teachers don't make any money, which is true. He also told me that I would never afford a home in Newport Beach, which is actually still true to this day. But no matter how cynical my father was about the state of economics and my new chosen profession, I thought, you know, I'm going to show my dad it's bigger. It's that aha moment, that invisible light bulb, when there's that connection, and you know that a kid gets it. On that first day, I'll never forget, I wore the exact same dress that Julia Roberts wore in the film Pretty Woman. I was decked out in polka dots, pearls. I got in my little convertible, and I was going to drive down Pacific Coast Highway. And as I was about to dart out that door, my father called in a complete panic. And he said, Erin, no matter what you do, please don't eat the apples. Because he had convinced himself they were laced with strychnine or razor blades. Okay, Pops. So as I made that 45-minute drive from suburbia into the inner city, what I didn't realize is that in that city alone, in 1 year, there was 126 murders. 126. So to be 14 years old and to constantly look over your shoulder, to walk through life like you have a bullseye on your chest, to stand in assembly lines at funeral parlors. And so at the crack of dawn, my kids got up in those housing projects, the Carmelitos housing project or the Springfield housing project, and they didn't put on brand new backpacks or pocket protectors. Most of my students were packing heat, because they'd convinced themselves by the time they were 14 years old, their options were limited. I'm gonna drop out of school by the end of this year. I'm probably gonna be behind bars by the time I'm 16, and worse yet, I'm gonna be 6 feet under by the time I'm 18. So when I walked into that classroom on that very first day with those polka dots and those pearls, I looked out at a sea of students who didn't see education as the greatest way to equalize a very unfair playing field. And I'll never forget my syllabus coming right back at me in the form of a paper airplane. And a young boy in that back corner raising his hand at Darius, and he said, why do we have to read books written by dead white guys in tights? Which is a very profound question. Because in Darius's mind, Homer was gonna leap out of the pages of a book and have his back every single day that he went home and was hit up. Where was he from? Who was he claiming? And Shakespeare wasn't gonna put food on the table for that hardworking single mom, because no matter how hard she worked, no matter how hard she tried, she was never gonna get that fancy house on the hill or her 15 minutes. And so every single day when Darius did the sign of the cross and wondered and wished, am I gonna make it home to kiss my hardworking mom goodnight, it was a struggle. On that same first day, in walked a little girl who changed my life forever. And she didn't waltz up to my desk and hand me that shiny red apple like my father had predicted. Instead, she walked into my classroom at the age of 14 with an ankle monitor around her leg and a probation officer. By the age of 14, she'd already been to boot camp and to juvenile hall again and again and again. And in her mind, it was just a matter of time before she screwed up again and was back behind bars, just like her daddy and her granddaddy before that. At the end of that first day, I went to see my principal completely demoralized. As I was scrubbing the graffiti off the desk and taking all the paper off the floor, and I just want to know, who are these students that I have period after period? And unfortunately, my principal was cynical. And he rattled off all these statistics that in our large school district of 97,000 kids, I had the lowest 150. The kids who weren't supposed to make it. The kids who just came from boot camp or juvenile hall like Maria and Darius. Or those kids who just came from rehab for crystal meth or crack cocaine. Or those kids who bounced around from foster home to group home to shelter. Kids who had learning disabilities diagnosed or not. And none of those mamas were gonna bake me brownies, and in retrospect, if they did, I probably shouldn't have eaten them anyways. But they weren't gonna return those phone calls, they weren't gonna come to back to school night meetings. So at the end of that day, my principal's parting shot was, I just hope these kids drop out before we take our standardized tests so that it'll pull the entire school score down. And I walked out of that office thinking, where are they going to go? There's 150 kids that I have throughout this day, and they're not going to be invisible, and they're not just going to disappear. And I don't want to send those kids back to the margins of our society. Somehow, some way, how do I give them a voice? How do I turn this classroom into something that is relevant and makes sense? So my first mistake was looking at Maria in that back corner. She'd come in with an ankle monitor, her probation officer, a black eye, and an attitude. And rather than scribbling notes, she would scribble on that desk. She would call me naughty names in Spanish. I eventually had to get a cheat sheet laminated to know what she was calling me. But I looked at this little girl and I thought, just like Shakespeare and just like Homer and everyone else on my syllabus, she and 149 others, they have a story. So how can I convince her to put down her fist, put down that gun or that spray can, pick up a pen and rewrite her own ending? Pick up a pen and right a wrong. So I went out and got these marble journals, I passed them out, and I waited with bated breath to see what Maria would tell, because I hoped that she would tell me about being a third-generation gang member, or about what it felt like to sleep on that cold concrete in a juvenile hall, or to cross her fingers and wonder and wish, is my daddy gonna come home this year to celebrate Christmas, knowing he wouldn't? Or what it felt like every single morning to see her hardworking mom get up at the crack of dawn, to go and clean those beautiful homes on that fancy hill, those beautiful homes that she realized we're never gonna live in, we're never gonna afford. And then she would watch her mom go off and scrub toilets in big fancy hotels that she realized we're never gonna stay in, we're never gonna afford. And then on some nights, her mom would go off for her third job, working her fingers to the bones in sweatshops, sewing beautiful dresses that her mama was never gonna wear. So I hoped in that moment, regardless of spelling and grammar and punctuation, that Maria would tell her story. Give a voice to that mama. Give a voice to that daddy. And instead, this is what Maria wrote on that first assignment. I hate Erin Gruwell. I hate Erin Gruwell. And if I wasn't on probation, I would probably shank her. Exclamation point. So she got her punctuation right. I grew up in suburbia, I didn't even know what shaking was, and if you don't know either, it's not good. So at that moment, I realized I have to figure out a different way to connect with my students. So I decided to play a game that was anything but a game. But I wanted my students to look around and to realize that this intolerance and this gang violence that was perpetuated on the streets of Long Beach could stop with them. So I put this piece of paint on the center of my floor and I was going to ask them questions. And every question was going to be this gravitational pull to the center of that room. And I knew I had to be sneaky, I knew I had to be subversive, so the first questions had to be about what they knew pop culture. Who had that new Snoop album, who'd seen Boys in the Hood, knowing that each and every one of those pop culture questions would bring them to the line. Because as teachers, that's what we compete against. We compete against those video games that are live and in 3D with images jumping off a screen. Or reality television. Or those hours upon hours when kids sneak into those darkened movie theaters and escape the reality. So for this brief moment, I wanted to convince my students that this game was all fun and games. And yet it was anything but. I'll never forget after those series of pop culture questions when I got real. So when I asked my students, stand on the line if you know anyone who is poor. And throughout that day, 150 kids out of 150 stood on that line. Because each and every one of my kids knew what it felt like in the pit of their stomach to be hungry. To go home and to open up that cabinet and there's nothing there. To look in that fridge and there's nothing there. And when you're 14 and you're poor, you don't want to let your buddies know that you can't afford breakfast or lunch. So for most of my kids, they didn't cash in that meal ticket. Because that meal ticket let everybody know that my mom was not good enough to feed me. So each and every kid stood on that line. They knew what it felt like to turn on that light switch and the lights don't come on. To get in that shower and there's no warm water. And so at that moment when I looked at that line and realized I've got them, everything changed. and the questions continued. And what my students did not realize is they were saying so much by not saying anything at all, by simply standing on a line. We saw them. We saw their story, and by seeing their story, we saw them. I'll never forget one of the questions. I asked my students to stand in line if you know somebody who has ever been homeless. And unlike every other question where the kids hightailed to that line, the first and only person who stood on that line was Sue Ellen. And she got to that line and she looked around and she realized, I'm the only one standing here, because that someone was her. And at that moment, as she stood in that line, I remember her looking at her feet, hoping that the floor would swallow her whole. That this crazy English teacher with those polka dots and pearls could move on to that next question, because if everybody on the other side of that room was looking at her, they would know that at the age of 14, every single day, this little girl would have to wake up and wonder where my next meal is coming from. And sit in those classes realizing I don't have deodorant or any feminine hygiene products. No one's ever going to ask me to a dance or any kind of football game. And as she was standing there for a second, which must have felt like hours, out came Tiffany with her beautiful braids. And unlike Sue Ellen, who just wanted to disappear, who just wanted me to move on to that next question, at that moment, Tiffany wanted every single one of us to see her. Because she knew that seeing her meant we did see her story, and in fact, we had. We had seen her story every single day when we left class, and Tiffany was standing on the corner of Pacific Coast Highway with a cardboard box. With a cardboard box that she had taken a marker from her art class and written, "We'll work for food." And at 14 years old, little Tiffany stood in that corner every day with a little tin cup, hoping that grown men would go by and feel sorry for her and put a couple coins in that cup, and maybe, just maybe, when she had enough coins, she could give it to her daddy and they could get that Fleabag hotel for a night. And without fail, every single day, her daddy would take those coins and he'd smoke it in a crack pipe. So at the age of 14, as my girl stood in that line, we realized what courage was. We realized what resiliency was. We realized that somehow, some way, this little girl still had the ability and the tenacity to try to do her homework, to try to read those stories. And if the mere presence of her was enough gravitational pull to bring out Narada. And when you're a boy and you just want to fit in, like our fabulous football player today, you don't want your buddies to know that you're homeless. You don't want your buddies to realize that you can't afford those fancy designer jeans or those Reeboks or those Nikes like those football stars. But in that moment when I saw Sue Ellen and Tiffany and Narada, I realized that every question that I asked since was going to higher the stakes, because I was going to know my students. I was going to know about those mamas and know about those daddies. And the questions did continue. Standing on the line about abuse. Standing on the line about depression. I'll never forget Calvin stood on this line, this beautiful boy, and at the age of 14, I felt like he had hate in his heart. Smoke was coming out of his ears and daggers were coming out of his eyes, and he stood on that line when I asked a question about abuse. Not knowing that he had been abused his entire life. You see, when he was just a little boy in kindergarten, he took those licks like a man, those cuts and those bruises, and even when he was in elementary school, he learned the game. You just wear long sleeves. You just put on a turtleneck. You just tell your teacher and your buddies that you got that black eye out on the football field. And this little boy was so busy playing the game because he realized, I can protect my seven brothers and sisters. And then he moved on to middle school. And one day, he came home from school and he realized, I was so busy playing that game that I never taught my little brothers and sisters how to play. And at that moment, when he saw his little sister in the back of a cop car, he realized that she must have gone to school. And that teacher must have seen those cuts and those bruises. And that teacher must have called Child Protective Services, and Child Protective Services called the cops. And at that moment, he realized, I am never going to be able to protect these little brothers and sisters again. And at the age of 14, as he is standing on a line in my classroom, I quickly learned that this little boy, at the age of 14, had already been to 42 foster homes. 42. And he was right. He never got to protect those brothers and sisters again. As I continued to ask questions that were plaguing our streets, that plague so many of our inner city streets, I realize that each and every one of these kids had a story. And if I could convince them to pick up that pen, go into that corner, go into the back of my classroom, take out a flashlight or a candle, and write their story. In that moment of writing their story, maybe they could immortalize it. Because for so many kids, they stood in line when I asked if they had buried someone to senseless gang violence. And Darius had told me he felt like he lived in an undeclared war. And yet we're not in Afghanistan or Iraq. But if you're 14 years old and you've buried 24 friends, that is a war. And so much so, Darius reminded me that he'd never even read an obituary. Never seen them in those newspapers or on the cover of magazines or talked about on that nightly news. So I told Darius and every one of those kids, go home and tell your story. And they did. And what I realized is I needed to find help. I needed to get books written by and for and about kids, kids who actually lived in the real wars. A little girl in a tiny little attic would look out her window and watch her friends being let off like sheep to slaughter. And yet every day, this little girl by the name of Anne Frank would pick up that pen and tell her story. Or about Ellie Wiesel, a teenage boy who was crammed into a cattle car, rode into Auschwitz-Birkenau, watched his entire family perish in a chimney. And as a young boy, he wrote about it. Or this little girl in the streets of Bosnia-Herzegovina would watch her friends get picked off by snipers in the streets of Sarajevo. So I went into the chair of my English department and said, is there any way that I can use these books written by and for and about kids? Kids who lived in real wars. Kids who fought back with language. And the chair of my English department was very cynical, and she had the rap sheets to prove it. So she told me in no uncertain terms that my students, my 150 kids, were too stupid, and they would never read a book from cover to cover. She went on to say they were dumb. She went on to say they were nothing. And as I was standing here, it reminded me of my father at a day that I'd come home that my father had always claimed that he'd named me in honor of Hank Aaron, this baseball legend. And some boys were picking on me at school saying that Aaron was a boy's name. And my father said, sticks and stones will break your bones, Aaron, but words will never hurt you. And standing in that teacher's lounge, I disagreed with my dad. Because I thought, what happens when we tell these kids again and again and again that they're dumb, that they're stupid, or they're nothing? What happens if they believe it? What happens if they act accordingly? What happens if those names become an albatross around their neck and weigh them down? So I marched back into my classroom, and I realized even though that I had no technology in my classroom, no textbooks, and I wasn't going to be able to get these books, somehow, some way, I was going to find a way. So I called my PTA president. I was this new, insecure teacher. But I said, I need help. I need help because my kids have never sat on their daddy's lap and even read about those green eggs and ham. My kids have never sat on their daddy's lap and identified Waldo. They've never read a book from cover to cover. They hate reading. They hate writing. And the only thing that seems to bring them together in perfect harmony is they really hate me, this perky, annoying cheerleader. Can you help me? And they said yes. So with their help, I went to a bookstore without thinking it through, and I ordered 150 copies of The Diary of Anne Frank, and 150 copies of Night by Elie Wiesel, and 150 copies of Zlatka's Diary. And then I stood at that cash register and realized, oh my God, I've just maxed out all of my credit cards, I've just used up all my PTA funds, I'm going to be paying these books off for 5 years, like a student loan. How can I actually convince kids who have never read a book to find themselves somewhere within those pages? So I decided that I was going to have this toast for change. And I decided that I was going to steal a cue from a kindergarten teacher, because I am convinced that kindergarten teachers are much more fun. And I visualized that when kindergarten teachers walk, flowers kind of magically sprout at their feet. And if you've ever walked into a kindergarten classroom, their bulletin board is much more sexy than my bulletin board. So I thought, I'm taking it back old school, back in the day. Back when there was show and tell, because my kids, they missed out on all that. for kids like Darius. That proud, proud mama told him not to tell. Or for kids like Calvin, there was nothing to show. So I wanted my kids at the age of 14 to have that do-over. That chance to come in to pick up a classic champagne glass with sparkling apple cider and think about doing things differently. Maybe they could be the ones that would break that cycle. Maybe they would be the ones to graduate and think about going to college. And maybe it didn't matter that kids like Darius had a 0.5 GPA, or kids like Maria had been kicked out of every school she ever attended. And I have to be honest, up until that moment, this toast for change in my mind was all about number two pistols and test scores and five paragraph essays and the hope that after they wrote that perfect five paragraph essay that my kids would moonwalk across the classroom and hand in their assignment, we could join hands, we could sing Kumbaya, and all would be right with the world. Because I had been brainwashed. I had been brainwashed to teach to a test. But on that fateful day, with my silly signs and my balloons and my plastic champagne glasses and my books all lined up, Maria Reyes walked into my classroom with an attitude and a swagger. She realized there was no place for her to sit. She looked at my signs, my polka dots, and my pearls, and then she rolled her eyes with, "Ugh, Miss G, you really need to stop going to Starbucks because you've had way too many lattes." And in her mind, she had no idea what this toast for change would symbolize. Because for her and so many other kids in our country, it's bigger than that number two pencil. It's bigger than that test score. It's bigger than statistics and data. So at the age of 14, Maria boldly picked up that plastic champagne glass. She got very serious, and she simply said, "I don't want to be pregnant by the time I turn 15 like my mama. And I don't want to spend the rest of my life behind bars like my daddy. And I don't want to be 6 feet under by the time I turn 18 like my cousin. I want to change." And at that moment when my students said, "I want to change," I think change was inevitable. Because for so many kids who were invisible, for so many kids who didn't have a voice, for the first time, people were listening. Darius stood up and he said, "I'm tired of being told to act like a man when there is no man in my house to show me or to guide me." And then Henry stood up and he said, "I'm tired of sitting on the edge of my bed on this Christmas and this birthday, waiting for my deadbeat dad to show up and bring me a present or tell me he loves me. And he never shows up." And kid after kid stood up. They were tired of being poor. They were tired of being picked on. They were tired of eating that government cheese. And at that moment, I realized, oh my God, I am not a counselor, I am not a therapist, I don't even know how to work that copy machine yet. How am I supposed to help these kids change? And if I can't, maybe my dad can help me. So for a brief moment, I'm going to ask you to go into my classroom, into room 203, and I'm gonna give you a brief glimpse of what it was like when my kids walked in, saw these plastic champagne glasses, these silly signs, and for the first time realized that change was on the horizon and they themselves could be those change agents. So for a brief moment, I'm going to bring you into my crazy, chaotic classroom, room 203.
One of these Borders bags, which contain the four books we're going to read this semester.
All right.
They're very special books, and they each remind me in some way of each of you. But before you take the books, I want you to take one of these glasses of sparkling cider, and I want each of you to make a toast. We're each gonna make a toast for change. And what that means is, from this moment on, every voice that told you you can't is silenced. Every reason that tells you things will never change disappears. the person you were before this moment, that person's turn is over. Now it's your turn. Okay? Okay. You ready to get this party going on? Ain't gonna happen.
Nobody ever listens to a teenager. Not everybody thinks you should be happy just because you're young. And they don't see the wars that we fight every single day. And one day my war will end. And I will not die. And I will not tolerate abuse from anyone. I am strong.
My mom's kicked me out when I got jumped into the gang life. I'd like her to see me graduate. I'd like to be 18.
Miss G, carry something from my diary?
That'd be great.
Summer in my short 14 years of life. It all started with a phone call. My mother was crying and begging, asking for more time, as if she were gasping for her last breath of air. She held me as tight as she could and cried. Her tears hit my shirt like bullets and told me we were being evicted. She kept apologizing to me. I thought I have no home. I should have asked for something less expensive at Christmas. On the morning of the eviction, a hard knock on the door woke me up. The sheriff was there to do his job. I looked up at the sky, waiting for something to happen. My mother has no family to lean on, no money coming in. Why bother coming to school or getting good grades if I'm homeless? The bus stops in front of the school. I feel like throwing up. I'm wearing clothes from last year, some old shoes and no new haircut. I kept thinking I'd get laughed at. Instead, I'm greeted by a couple of friends who were in my English class last year. And it hits me, Mrs. Gruwell, my crazy English teacher from last year, is the only person that made me think of hope. Talking with friends about last year's English and our trips, I began to feel better. I received my schedule, and the first teacher is Mrs. Gruwell, room 203. I walk into the room and feel as though all the problems in life are not so important anymore. I am home.
When I think of PTA, that's what I think of. I think of home, because that first word is parents. And for so many of my kids, they just needed a place to feel safe. They needed to validate those hardworking mamas, those aunties, those grandmas. They needed to fill that void. And so the first thing I realized after that young boy said, I feel home, I realized that I needed to fill my classroom with all of those parents, starting with my father. My students call me Miss G, so they quickly renamed my father Papa G. And suddenly Papa G was gonna go on every field trip. He was gonna teach those young boys how to tie that tie, how to pull out that chair for a young girl, to get in these wonderful critical thinking debates about misogyny and rap music. And then I just decided to tap all my PTA moms, and we named them in honor of the Chicago Bulls, and we called them the Dream Team. So in came my posse. And those moms came to each and every event we did. because I realized that I wanted to take my students out into the world and bring the world into my classroom. And suddenly my students started realizing that all of those things that people said about us, they're not true. Because maybe we could change that dialogue, change that discussion. We could be the first in our families to make it. So I was able to stay with those students their freshman year, their sophomore year, their junior year, and on the eve of their senior year, I looked at every single face, 150 strong, and I realized they're gonna graduate. The first in their families. And they're not just gonna stop there. They wanna take that story out into the world like a message in a bottle. And that message was from all of those moments of standing on that line, because that scene you just saw, that wasn't written by some screenwriter in Hollywood. That was Narada's story. That was Narada's story when he stood in line letting everyone know I'm homeless. And he was vulnerable and he was exposed and he didn't know what to do with that story. So he went home and he picked up a pen and a journal and he told his story. Unbeknownst to him that story was going to transform all of us. To give every other kid the opportunity to tell their story. Scream it to the rafters, to anyone that's listening. And so my students decided to write this book. And behind the scenes, we called it the little book that could, like that engine going down the tracks, I think I can. And we sent these stories to every single publishing house in the country. And every single publishing house rejected us. Except for one. Except for the same folks who took a chance on a little girl in a tiny little attic. And so my students decided to release this book out into the world. They realized that once it's out there, other kids who look like them and talk like them and come from a place that they come from, they too can change. They too can have that do-over. They too can honor those mamas and those adopted daddies. And as the story started to get a little bit of a buzz, my father got very cocky, and he started casting himself. And I would get these calls from my father, and I would answer the phone to my dad and say, you know, I think that Jack Nicholson should play me. And I'd be like, Dad, it's not that kind of movie. A couple days would go by, I'd get a call, it'd be Pops again, and Pops would be like, hey, how about Robert Redford? I'm like, Dad, it's not that kind of movie. And this little routine would go back and forth. And then my dad died. And my dad died before this book, and before this movie, and before I had a chance to go back to Cincinnati and learn all about that team that he worked with so many years ago. And so I stand before you, knowing the importance of parents, to honor them when you got them, to honor their legacy when you don't. And so for each and every proud parent in this room, what you don't realize is you get to be that parent to a little boy like Calvin as he's finding his way, as he's going from foster home to foster home, saying, someday, I just want to feel normal. Someday, I just want to fit in. Someday, I just want one adult to pull me closer rather than push me away, to give me a hug rather than a slap across the face. So I stand before you as an ordinary person who had an extraordinary experience. Because of parents. Parents who saw something in my kids that they didn't see in themselves. My own father who could nudge me and challenge me and make me try harder. But most importantly, every single one of those noble PTA moms and fathers who said, we believe in your kids. I stand before you having created these civil rights activists. Because 150 students now think they're gonna change the world one kid, one class, one community at a time. And on that very first day, Maria Reyes waltzed into my classroom with this attitude and a swagger, a black eye, and an ankle monitor. Just recently, she walked into the halls of Congress, and it's a scary place. And she walked into those halls of Congress not seeing red or blue, I think she saw purple. She didn't have her probation officer, she didn't have her ankle monitor, she looked like J-Lo, she acted like she owned the joint with her 5-inch stilettos. And secretly, I don't think the Secret Service did a very good background check because they let her in. stormed in. She stormed in that room, and she wanted every single one of our nation's leaders to give a voice to those kids in public schools, to give a voice to those parents who are tirelessly working for them. And in the middle of her speech, she turned around and she whispered to me, "Oh my God, there's so many old white men in here." But just like those great Cincinnati Reds baseball players who would point to the rafters like Babe Ruth and knock it out of the park, my girl stood there and she hit a home run. And as she was telling her story, it wasn't her story, it was a story of every single kid who is invisible, who doesn't have a voice, who needs hope and a home. And so that's what each and every one of you get to do. When you come together, you get to go back and see something in your kids, whether they are biological or part of your community. You get to see promise. You get to see possibility. But most importantly, you get to see hope. So thank you for what you did. Thank you for being a part of this journey, for all of those teachers and for all of those kids. Thank you.
Dedicating your work to educating our country's children and for inspiring us with your incredible story. This is just a little something to show our appreciation for all that you have done and continue to do. Thank you.
The final moment, the crescendo of Maria being in the halls of Congress, I know that this evening you have Arne Duncan, our Secretary of Education. Well, Maria looked at all of those old white men who were crying, taking out their handkerchiefs. And her final words were, "You know, gentlemen, I am going to be the first Latina Secretary of Education." And she smiled. So I need all of you to tell my boy Arne that Maria is hot on his trail. She's got her eyes on Pennsylvania Avenue. And when she gets there, we should be so lucky. So thank you.
No more handouts for schools. Instead, waves of new customers seeking out your business, intentionally making new purchases locally, knowing a portion benefits their school. That's Boosterville. Sell local, buy local, boost local, Boosterville.